Good morning, students. Today's topic will be on liver function tests. As we have covered in the last topic about the kidney function test, similarly, when you go for a blood test, apart from the blood cell counts, you have many other parameters which would be taken into consideration for a liver function. So among them, the most important ones are the bilirubin, alkaline phosphatase, aspartate transaminase, alanine transaminase, gamma glutamyl transpeptidase, albumin, and prothrombin time. So among them, the SGOT and SGPT, which we call as aspartate transaminase and alanine transaminase, are the most important, and the normal range of them ranges between 5 to 40 international units per liter. Whereas the bilirubin, the normal levels range from 5 to 17 micromoles per liter, and alkaline phosphatase ranges between 35 to 130 international units per liter, and above or below the range would show that there is something abnormal about the liver function. This table depicts some of the diseases which are listed here, such as the viral hepatitis, drug-induced hepatitis, chronic active hepatitis, the cirrhosis, the biliary cirrhosis, alcoholic cirrhosis, the cholestasis, and hepatoma. So in these clinical conditions, you can see that these transaminases, the ALT and AST, the SGOT and SGPT levels are pretty high in case of hepatitis, and such increased levels show that there is something abnormal about the liver. Along with it, the glutamyl transpeptidase, the gamma glutamyl transpeptidase levels were also seen to be higher in diseases such as, in conditions such as cirrhosis, where the liver undergoes problem and the part of the liver is become dysfunctional. So what are these liver function tests? So the liver function tests are also known as liver chemistries, and they help to determine the health of your liver, and thereby we are measuring the levels of certain enzymes or proteins and the bilirubin in your blood. The liver function test is often recommended in several situations, such as to check if there is a damage due to some infections such as hepatitis C or hepatitis B, and to monitor certain medications which may damage the liver, and thereby these medications have to be taken into consideration. For example, people say that certain medications can impact the liver function. So if you have, because liver is an organ wherein most of the toxic compounds are being removed and most of the metabolism happens in the liver. So if you have already have a liver disease, to monitor the disease, and to see if there is a specific treatment which is given to improve from the liver disease, how much your liver has improved. In order to do that, one need to perform the liver function test to see the parameters, if there is an improvement in these parameters. Or if you are experiencing the symptoms of liver disorder, or if you have very high level of triglycerides, or you have very low blood count such as anemia conditions, or high blood pressure, or have a diabetes. In such conditions also, these functions are being tested. People who who drink alcohol very heavily also their liver may be impacted. And people who have gallbladder diseases, their liver function have to be tested. So all these conditions say that these are the criteria for which a liver function test need to be done. So why do I need a liver function test? So the liver function test, they can help to determine if the liver is working correctly, and the liver performs a number of, because it performs a number of vital functions. Like we said before, that there are, most of the metabolism happens in the liver, and the detoxification process also happens in the liver, because the liver helps in removing the toxic compounds and metabolizing them. So the removing the contaminants from your blood is very key factor, and thereby the liver function test is required. And also converting the nutrients from foods which you eat. So all the carbohydrates are metabolized, and some of them are stored in the liver. And there are various vitamins and minerals which we studied in the earlier classes are also known to be stored in the liver. And they are known to regulate the clotting process, blood clotting process. They are known to produce cholesterol or enzymes or proteins, and the bile, which is important for the digestion of the lipids. And they are important in making factors which are important for fighting the infection process and to remove the bacteria from the blood. And also for processing substances that can harm your body. And thereby they also maintains the hormonal balance, and they are important in regulating the blood sugar levels. So what are the various symptoms which a liver disorder, in a liver disorder one see? So majorly major symptoms include fatigueness. So that means a lot of energy, tiredness, weakness, weight loss, jaundice, which means skin becomes yellow and the eye becomes yellow, and the fluid collection in the abdomen, and which we call as ascites, and the discolored bodily discharge, and that means the color of the urine becomes very dark or the stools become very light in color. Apart from this, people see nausea, the vomiting like sensation, diarrhea, abdominal pain, or abdominal bleeding. So there are various tests which are commonly used to check these liver abnormalities, and such as the alanine transaminase, ALT, and aspartate aminotransferase, AST, which we call as SGOT and SGPT in other terms. And the alkaline phosphatase, ALP, albumin, and bilirubin. The transaminases, the ALT and AST, which are SGOT and SGPT tests, they measure the enzymes that your liver releases in response to damage or disease. So the albumin test measures how will the liver creates the albumin, and the bilirubin test measures how well it disposes of the bilirubin. Because through the albumin, most of the drugs or the most of the agents are transported through the albumin to the liver. And also the alkaline phosphatase can be used to evaluate the bile duct system of the liver. So how do we determine the serum bilirubin? So this picture depicts the catabolism of heme. So we know that the senescence of the red blood cells are major source of the heme proteins. So the red blood cells in the blood vessels are broken down, and these are the sources of the heme proteins. And this, the breakdown of this heme protein to bilirubin occurs in the macrophages of the reticuloendothelial system. So this is the lining of these blood vessels, which we call as endothelial system. And the reticuloendothelial system, or the tissue macrophage, spleen, liver, all these places. So the breakdown of heme happens, and this is getting converted to the bilirubin. Further, so this is an unconjugated bilirubin which is transported through the blood, and it is complex with the albumin, and it enters the liver. So this is the liver here, and this unconjugated bilirubin, due to the breakdown of heme, is transported through the blood to the liver with the help of albumin. And further, this bilirubin is taken up by the liver, and This gets conjugated with glucuronic acid, and so this bilirubin gets complexed with conjugated with glucuronic acid, and this again is secreted from the liver into the intestine. So in the intestine, this conjugated bilirubin, which is conjugated with glucuronic acid, is released into the is released in the bile from the liver into the intestine. And further, what happens in the intestine is, in the intestine, the glucuronic acid is removed because the intestine has a lot of bacteria, and which results in the bilirubin being converted to the urobilinogen. So the urobilinogen is produced during this process because of the presence of the bacteria in the intestine, which breaks this conjugated glucuronic acid bilirubin conjugate, and it is getting converted to urobilinogen, which is shown here. Further, some of this urobilinogen is reabsorbed in the gut and it enters into the portal blood. And there is other portion of this urobilinogen which participates in the enterohepatic urobilinogen cycle. So this is so one gets into the cycle. You can see the cycle here, or it gets into the bloodstream and it enters into the bloodstream, and finally through the kidney it gets excreted out. And the remaining of this urobilinogen is transported by the blood to the kidney, where it is converted to the yellow color urobilin, and that's why it is excreted through the urine, and our urine is yellowish in color because of this. And in the end, the urobilinogen is further getting oxidized by the intestinal bacteria, and they form this brown stercobilin, which is excreted out in the form of the feces. So again, to summarize this whole thing, the senescent red blood cells are major source of the hemoproteins. There is a breakdown of this heme to the bilirubin, which occurs in the macrophages of the reticuloendothelial system. And this unconjugated bilirubin from this breakdown of heme is transported through the blood by complexing with the albumin to the liver. In the liver, the bilirubin is getting conjugated with the glucuronic acid, and then it is secreted into the intestine, where the glucuronic acid is removed, and it results in the formation of urobilinogen. So this portion of the urobilinogen is reabsorbed into the blood. It is again absorbed into the blood, where it is getting converted into yellow color urobilin, and it is excreted by the kidneys in the urine, and that's why urine gets yellow color. And further, the remaining urobilinogen is oxidized by the intestinal bacteria to brown color feces, which is stercobilin. So this again is a picture depicting that how hemoglobin in the red blood cells is broken down into heme and globin, and this, in the presence of heme oxygenase, gets converted to biliverdin 9 alpha, and this biliverdin 9 alpha, in the presence of biliverdin reductase, in the presence of NADPH, gets converted to bilirubin, which is water insoluble and it is unconjugated form, which gets transported to the liver with the help of the albumin, and it reaches the liver, and then it is conjugated with glucuronic acid to UDP glucuronic acid, and it becomes water soluble, and this is called bilirubin diglucuronide. Further, this is secreted in through the bile ducts into the intestines, and then it forms the urobilinogen, and this urobilinogen formed by the bacteria gets either excreted in the form of a stercobilin, giving guys characteristic brown color feces, or it can be converted to urobilin and is excreted into the urine through the kidneys. So the normal range of bilirubin is 1 to 16 micromoles per liter. So that means 0.1 to 1 mg per deciliter, or it is 4/5 of the unconjugated bilirubin, and others are the conjugated bilirubin. And the normal range is less than 1 mg per deciliter, whereas the occult conditions, you have 1 to 2 mg per deciliter. More than 2 mg per deciliter leads to jaundice. So this occult and the jaundice, where the levels of the bilirubin are high, are called hyperbilirubinemia. So this hyperbilirubinemia is the condition where the concentration of the blood bilirubin is more than 1 mg per deciliter. And whereas the occult condition, which we said, therein we see there is a high concentration of bilirubin, and but there is no clinical symptom. That means it has 1 to 2 mg per deciliter, but there is no jaundice-like symptom. The third condition is the typical jaundice, which refers to yellow coloration of the skin, which is caused by the deposition of bilirubin, and it is secondary to the increased bilirubin levels in the blood. Although not the disease itself, jaundice is usually a symptom of an underlying disorder. You can see here the eyes typically becomes yellowish in color, the skin becomes very pale, and even in the kids at the time of birth, this is condition is seen, wherein the kids are kept in the incubator under the presence of light. So this whole process from the red blood cells, the senescence of the red blood cells, or the production of the unconjugated bilirubin from the heme to the conjugated bilirubin in the liver with the help of glucuronic acid, and this conjugated bilirubin getting into the kidney, and this urobilinogen getting converted into different forms. Either they are getting excreted through the urine, or becoming stercobilin and get out of the body as the brown color feces. And during this condition, the transaminases AST, ALT are some of the parameters where the liver functions are measured. So based on the pathophysiology, jaundice may result from one or more of the following mechanisms: either increased bilirubin production, that means excessive red cell destruction. So if there is too much red cell destruction, which is the anemia condition, may lead to increased bilirubin production. On the other hand, there are certain drugs, or prolonged starvation, or sepsis condition, where there is a decreased hepatic uptake is seen. And decreased hepatic conjugation may be due to the presence of enzymes or drugs, or due to the non-functional liver due to the cirrhosis, wherein the liver gets non-functional, part of the liver becomes non-functional, or due to the decreased excretion of the bilirubin in the bile, which may be due to the gallstone formation, or there is a tumor, and so thereby secretion is not happening. So the jaundice is classified predominantly into three types: the prehepatic jaundice, which is called as hemolytic jaundice, and second is hepatic jaundice, and third is post-hepatic cholestatic or obstructive jaundice. The hemolytic jaundice, wherein a massive lysis of the red blood cells is seen in patients with sickle cell anemia or malaria, may produce bilirubin faster than the liver can conjugate it. And thereby more bilirubin is excreted into the bile, and the amount of urobilinogen entering into the hepatic circulation is increased, and the urinary urobilinogen is also increased in this case. And the unconjugated bilirubin is elevated in the blood. The second condition is hepatocellular jaundice, wherein the damage is happening to the liver cells, for example, in patients with cirrhosis or hepatitis, may cause a decrease in both bilirubin uptake and production of conjugated bilirubin. So the unconjugated bilirubin occurs in the blood, and increased urobilinogen is seen in the urine. So the urine is dark in color, and the stool becomes pale or the clay in color. And the plasma levels of the aminotransferases and the both AST and the ALT, the aspartate aminotransferase or the alanine aminotransferase, are elevated, and the patient experiences the nausea in this condition. The third is obstructive jaundice. In this, the jaundice results from the obstruction of the bile duct. For example, the presence of a tumor or a bile stone may block the bile ducts and preventing the passage of the bilirubin into the intestine. And the patients with obstructive jaundice experience gastrointestinal pain, nausea. They produce stools that are pale or plain color. And you can see here the serum indexes, and in the serum, the total bilirubin, direct bilirubin, indirect bilirubin. So you can see there is a elevated levels of both the in obstructive jaundice and the hepatic jaundice. You can see increase in the amounts of the total bilirubin as well as the direct bilirubin, whereas in normal condition it is less than one, whereas in these disease condition it is more than one. Also, the urine color, if you see, this becomes deeper in case of obstructive or the hemolytic or the hepatic jaundice. And further, the stool color also is known to be changing. So the clinical the concentration of the unconjugated bilirubin is equal to the total bilirubin minus the conjugated bilirubin, and the clinical significance of this whole thing is, so in an older child or adult, the normal values of bilirubin are from 0 to 0.4 milligrams per deciliter, whereas the normal values of the total bilirubin are from 0.3 to 1 mg per deciliter. So the normal indirect bilirubin in a newborn would be under 5.2 mg per deciliter within the first 24 hours of birth, whereas the abnormal bilirubin concentrations in serum, it majorly reflects the symptoms of many diseases like the hepatitis or the Gilbert syndrome, which is a genetic disease, and the cirrhosis, that means the scarring of the liver, or the biliary structure where the parts of the bile duct is too narrow to allow the fluid to pass, or due to the presence of a stone, a gallbladder stone, or having a cancer in pancreatic or the gallbladder region, or drug toxicity. So the high bilirubin may also be due to the problems in the blood instead of the problems in the liver, and the blood cells start breaking down too fast, and this can be caused by either the hemolytic anemia, which occurs when there are too many blood cells who are being destroyed by an autoimmune disease or a genetic defect, or due to the toxicity or infection reactions, or the transfusion reaction. So this occurs when your immune cells attacks blood that was given to you through the transfusion. So if a patient is given transfusion, so the body recognizes the foreign cells, and thereby they can, immune system can attack these new cells. And on the other hand, in an infant, the high or usually indirect bilirubin and jaundice can be very dangerous and may caused by several factors. And there are three common types, such as physiological jaundice, which are at day 2 to 4 after birth. And this is caused by brief delay in functioning of the liver, but it is not actually much serious. And whereas the breastfeeding jaundice, which happens during the first week of life, and it is caused by a baby not nursing well and low milk supply in the mother. The third is due to the breast milk jaundice, and after 2 to 3 weeks of life, and it is caused by processing of some substances in the breast milk. So the next test is aspartate aminotransferase, which is an enzyme that is found in several parts of your body, including heart, liver, and muscles. The activity of this enzyme shows the health of the heart, liver, and the muscles. Since this aspartate aminotransferase levels are not as specific for liver damage as the ALT, it is usually measured together with ALT to check for the liver problems. So mostly the SGOT and SGPT both are done together, both for AST and ALT. When the liver is damaged, AST can be released into the bloodstream, and a high result on an AST test might indicate a problem with the liver or the muscles. So the normal range of AST is typically 40 international units per liter in adults, and maybe higher in infants and younger children. Whereas the alkaline phosphatase is an enzyme which is found in the bones, bile duct, and liver. So alkaline phosphatase test is typically ordered in combination with several other tests, and high level of alkaline phosphatase may be indicate the liver inflammation or the blockage of the bile ducts or the bone disease. And children and adolescents, they may experience high levels of alkaline phosphatase because their bones are growing, and pregnancy can also increase the amount of alkaline phosphatase. The normal range is 120 units per liter in adults. So further, albumin is also very important because after the heme lysis, the bilirubin is getting transported with the help of albumin to the liver. So albumin is main protein made by your liver, and it performs many important functions. Especially, it stops the fluid from leaking out of the body from the blood vessels, and it nourishes your tissue, and it transports hormones, vitamins, and other drugs and other substances through your body. So an albumin test measures how well your liver is making this albumin, and a low level indicates that the liver is not functioning very well. So the normal range of albumin is 3.5 to 5 grams per deciliter. However, low albumin can also result of poor nutrition, kidney disease, infection, or inflammation. And thank you very much.